Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 10th of June 2020. The list of news articles taken up for today's analysis is displayed here along with the page numbers of 5 different editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is displayed in the description section and also in the comment section in the best interest of the viewers. Let us now begin our analysis. Now let us look at this editorial, which tries to explain how the India-China border dispute is different from India-Pakistan border dispute. See, in this context, from exam point of view, know that India shares borders with these countries. Here, many of you might know this trick, Bachpan MBA. For those who are new to UPSC preparation, you can make use of this mnemonic, Bachpan MBA, where BA stands for Bangladesh, CH for China, PA for Pakistan, N for Nepal, and in MBA, M for Myanmar, B for Bhutan, and A for Afghanistan. This is in the decreasing order of length of the boundaries which India shares with these countries. So you can see that India shares 3,488 km of border with China, and this runs along the union territory of Ladakh, Himachal Pradesh, then Uttarakhand, then Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh. See, this border is not fully demarcated, and the process of clarifying and confirming the line of actual control between India and China is in progress. And if you look at the India-Pakistan border, it extends 3,323 km, which also includes 742 km of the line of control. The border runs along the union territories of Ladakh and Jammu and Kashmir, then across the states of Punjab, Rajasthan and Gujarat. And we know that the Pakistan is illegally occupying the Kashmir region for many years since India's independence. And even Pakistan is claiming that the entire Jammu and Kashmir is a part of Pakistan. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about how the India-China border dispute is different from the India-Pakistan border dispute. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, we have given two maps. The first map shows the status quo of India's border with our neighbors, and the second one shows India's perception of the border. When we tell neighbors, it means the countries of China and Pakistan. Now let us look into the author's viewpoints. The author says that in recent days, China and Pakistan have joined their hands in challenging India's presence in the Kashmir-Ladakh region. See, Pakistan has increased the activity of infiltrating the terrorists into the Kashmir Valley. At the same time, China has undertaken provocative measures on the Ladakh front to assert its control over the disputed areas around the line of actual control. Here, the author is of the opinion that India should not conflate, that is, combine both these disputes as they are different in nature. Now, let us see a brief history of the border disputes which India has with both these countries. It is especially useful for the freshers, as you will get an overall idea from a historical perspective. See, India-Pakistan problems began just after the partition in the year 1947. Pakistan's dispute with India is an ideological dispute. It has claimed that the erstwhile Muslim-majority princely state of Jammu and Kashmir legitimately belongs to Pakistan. And the latest threat to this claim was the dilution of Article 370 by India. See, here Pakistan knows that it is a weak military power. So, it has resorted to the use of unconventional means, like terrorist infiltration along the line of control. That is, using non-state actors along the borders. Now, if you come to the India-China border dispute, it is not an ideological dispute. The author tells that China's perceived the dilution of Article 370 in a different way. It knows that now Ladakh is separated from the Kashmir problem, and it gives India a freer hand in contesting China's claims in the region. And we know that India has augmented its infrastructure building on India's path close to this line of actual control. And in 2019, the External Affairs Minister of India stated that the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir region belongs to India, and one day India will have physical jurisdiction over it. Now, in this context, you need to know about the region of Ladakh. See, it borders China's provinces of Xinjiang and Tibet. In Xinjiang, the Uyghur Muslims are present who are revolting against the Chinese communist ideology. Similarly, we have the Buddhist resistance in the Tibetan region. So, Ladakh borders with both Xinjiang and Tibet. Another issue is India's claim of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. See, this Pakistan-occupied Kashmir includes Gilgit and Baltistan. And now, the issue is China has invested heavily in this Pakistan-occupied Kashmir region under the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor project. So it is clear that China does not want India to get more control in Ladakh, which includes the Chinese-occupied Aksai Chin area as well. So we can say that for China, Ladakh is primarily a territorial dispute with strategic consequences. And we know that China has a superior military force, so it is resorting to confrontations across the line of actual control in order to underline its claims. So the author tells that China is actually concerned about the changing status quo in Ladakh and not in the Kashmir region. But if you see, Pakistan is committed to use all ways and means to change the status quo in Kashmir region in its favor. So here the author tries to differentiate between the India-China border dispute and the India-Pakistan border dispute. One is ideological and the other is a strategic one. Here the author believes that the territorial dispute with China is negotiable on a give and take basis. But this is not possible in case of Pakistan because Pakistan considers Kashmir as a zero-sum game. It means a gain for India is a loss for Pakistan and vice versa. So the author believes that India should not conflict, that is, combine both the border disputes. Instead, it should distinguish the nature of Pakistani and Chinese disputes. So the author tells that though the disputes seem to be overlapping on both Ladakh and Kashmir, it requires different strategies. So this is in brief about the discussion of this editorial. Now, why this editorial has been titled Pincer Provocation? Because it indicates attack in two places at the same time or at once with the aim of surrounding. In this case, the two sides are Pakistan and China for India. So the author tells that India needs two different strategies. This is all about the discussion of this editorial. So to summarize, we have seen how the author tries to establish the fact that the border dispute between India and Pakistan is different from the border dispute between India and China. Now have a look at this practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This op-ed article is regarding climate change, which has been written by a field expert. He has discussed about two important and interrelated parameters that are responsible for climate change, and he has discussed certain timeline of events related to climate change. So now let us look at them. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this editorial is given here for your reference. See, climate changes, the changes in average weather conditions that persist over multiple decades or even longer than this. And it includes both increases and the decreases in the temperature, as well as shifts in the precipitation, that is the rainfall, then severe weather events, and even changes to other features of the climate system. Thus, it involves not just a change in the temperature, but every other component of weather, including rainfall, humidity, wind speed, etc. So, with the help of two interrelated curves, the author of this editorial tries to explain how climate change is visible. The first curve which the author has discussed is the atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide. See, the author tells that this carbon dioxide curve began its upward trend about 18,000 years ago. At that time, there was a little less than 200 parts per million, that is ppm of carbon dioxide, as you can see in this graph. So, Earth was much colder during this period. And you can also see here that over the past million years, the carbon dioxide levels never exceeded 280 to 300 ppm. But in the mid-19th century, the carbon dioxide concentration has started rising at an unprecedented rate. Why so? It is mostly because of the burning of the fossil fuels for energy purposes. Additionally, the humans have also burned forests to expand agriculture and also to expand their settlements. So because of this, in 2013, the carbon dioxide levels crossed 400 ppm for the first time. And in the year 2018, the carbon dioxide concentration reached 407 ppm, which is higher than at any point in the past 8 lakh years. So this is the first curve. The second curve, which the author has discussed, is the average global temperature curve. As you can see in this picture, from 1850 onwards, the global temperature showed a slight warming trend. But from 1975 onwards, it has shown an upward trend. And by 2015-16, the globe, that is the Earth, had heated by 1 degree Celsius. Based on this, it is projected that by the end of this century, the globe will heat up by 4 degrees Celsius. So this is about the average global temperature curve. Now, how they are interrelated? The increase in carbon dioxide concentration leads to the increase in the temperatures across the globe. So we can see that these two interrelated curves have begun their upward trend with the origin of industrial age. So this industrial age not only led to the increase in the carbon dioxide emissions, but also increase in the greenhouse gas emissions. That is those gases that increase the temperature of the globe. So it is important to curb the greenhouse gas emissions. For this, the international organizations came up with many agreements which put the responsibility on the countries through targets in order to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions within a stipulated time period. So one such agreement is the most well-known agreement, which is the Paris Climate Agreement of 2015. But if you see, the costs that are involved in achieving the climate targets are quite high. For example, the wealthy nations are spending over $500 billion every year within their country on projects that are aimed at reducing emissions. Even if you see, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change estimated that sustained annual investment of about $2.4 trillion in more energy efficient systems is required until the year 2035. So only then we can keep the global warming well below 1.5 degree Celsius. But if you see, these kinds of investment and spending are possible by wealthy developed nations, but not by developing nations or the least developed nations. Whereas you need to note one more scenario here, developed countries like USA were the major emitters of the greenhouse gas emissions that resulted in global warming. But if you see now, the price has to be paid by everyone, because every country across the world has now the onus to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions. So because of such inequalities, the wealthy nations agreed to pay other countries to cope up with their climate change issues at the UN Climate Conference, which happened in the year 2009. It happened at Copenhagen in Denmark, and COP15 was a part of this conference. The countries pledged to provide $100 billion in aid each year by the year 2020 to poorer countries for climate change mitigation and adaptation. But if you see, there are criticisms around such aid. For example, in 2017, only $71 billion was provided by the developed nations. So based on this, the authors of the opinion that the rich countries are unlikely to deliver their target of $100 billion every year, especially during the year 2020. As we all know that at present the world is crippled with COVID-19 pandemic and all the economies are hit. And also due to the pandemic, the industrial activities have come to a standstill. In one way, it is advantageous because it has led to the reduction in the carbon emissions from fossil fuels. But if this has to continue post COVID-19, then we need to have a shift in the structure and functioning of the societies. So the author stresses on this fact, and here the author has discussed about the usage of technology to suck out billions of tons of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and store this safely somewhere else. For example, inventions like smog towers that capture and collect the polluted air, where this polluted air that contains the carbon particles will be turned into diamonds. And also, if you see, there is an idea to regulate solar radiation by geoengineering. Here, geoengineering refers to the deliberate large-scale manipulations of the Earth's environment that are designed to offset some of the harmful consequences of the greenhouse gas-induced climate change. One of the approaches in this is the solar radiation management. The goal is limiting the effect of sunlight on the Earth. So it includes possible methods such as sending a giant sunshade up into the orbit or releasing aerosols into the stratosphere, etc. But if you see, such ideas could also bring unpleasant effects as well. And they are in turn quite costly technology as well. This is the reason why the author concludes that there is no substitute for reducing the greenhouse gas emissions. Here the author's viewpoint is that instead of creating a problem and trying to reduce the side effects of the problems, it is better to prevent the problems at the first hand. So the author stresses that the technologists, the economists, and the social scientists must plan for a sustainable planet based on the principles of equity and climate justice, not only within the nations, but also across the nations. So this is all about the discussion of this editorial. To summarize, we have seen about the author's views on two interrelated parameters that are responsible for the climate change events across the globe, based on which he has also discussed about certain timeline of events in curbing the greenhouse gas emissions that are responsible for climate change. Now have a look at this practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article discusses about the performance of the Indian universities in the QS World University Rankings 2021. In this context, you need to know in brief about these rankings. CQS rankings, also called as Quaccarelli-Simons rankings, are provided by Quaccarelli-Simons, which is a British company that is specialized in higher education services. See, these QS World University rankings evaluate the performance of the universities across the world using these six metrics. Their weightages are given in brackets for your reference. Here you need to know that the academic reputation and the employer reputation is calculated by QS based on surveys. And next, if you see the faculty-student ratio, it assesses the extent to which the institutions are able to provide students with meaningful access to lecturers and tutors, that is faculties. So this metric will recognize that a higher number of faculty members per student will reduce the teaching burden each individual academic. Next, coming to citations per faculty, we all know that in an institution, teaching is one key pillar. The another key pillar is research output. So the citations per faculty is related to the research output. So the researchers publish their research papers, and many people will look at these research papers and refer to them for their research, and they will cite it in their research paper. So this is what we mean by citation. So this QS will calculate the number of citations that are received by all papers that are produced by an institution across a certain time period by the number of faculty members at that institution. So this is what is citations per faculty. And these next two parameters, which are international faculty ratio and international student ratio, are self-explanatory. The number of international faculty and international students who are present in a particular university at the time of ranking assessment. So these are the six metrics with their weightages given here. Now, apart from this, there is QS World University Rankings by subject. This identifies the world's strongest universities every year in 48 individual subject areas. So this is in brief about QS World University Rankings. Now let us come to the news article. This news article discusses about the key rankings of the Indian universities in QS World University Rankings 2021. It tells that the total number of Indian universities in the top 1000 global list has fallen from 24 universities to 21 universities. Now we know that the central government announced the Institutes of Eminence scheme in order to boost the presence of Indian universities, Indian institutions in global rankings. But despite the efforts by the government, we can see that the numbers in the rankings have dropped. Very few institutions like IIT Guwahati and IIT Hyderabad have performed better in this ranking. And from private universities, OP Jindal Global University from Haryana has shown an improvement in the ranking. Now let us see why Indian universities have not performed well in the rankings. According to the compilers of the rankings, the Indian higher education performs most strongly in measure of research quality. But if you see, the institutions in India are failing to increase their academic standing, teaching capacity, and levels of internationalization. That is, in parameters like faculty-student ratio, international faculty ratio, international student ratio, etc. So this news article mentions that the Indian universities have performed the poorest in terms of international faculty ratio and international student ratio parameters, because they have scored zero on these two metrics. Also, they have scored poorly on faculty-student ratio, but they have scored well on the research-related metric, which is citations per faculty. So this is in brief about this news article. Additionally, know that Massachusetts Institute of Technology from US is ranked as the world's best university, and this is followed by Stanford University and Harvard University. This is all about the discussion of this news article. To summarize, we have seen about the QS World University Rankings, its six metrics, and the news article which discusses about the relatively poor performance of the Indian institutions in these rankings and the reasons. Now, you can make use of any of these metrics in a mains question if you would have the necessity to discuss about the status of higher education institutions in India and why they are not globally competent. You can tell that they have a poor international faculty ratio or international student ratio despite having a strong research base. So always try to extract one or two important points from news articles like these. Let us move on to the next news article. This question is based on this news article, which says that the coffee sector is struggling from labor shortage due to a reverse migration of migrant laborers to their hometowns. So as a solution, one of the professional services firm mentioned in this news article has suggested that the coffee growers can avail the services of MGNREGA workers under MGNREGA scheme. If you remember, yesterday we have discussed in detail about this MGNREGA scheme. You can have a look at it for your reference. Now, in the context of this news article and in this question, let us discuss in brief about Indian coffee. See, in India, coffee cultivation is mainly done in the southern states. About 54% of coffee is cultivated in Karnataka. So you can see that more than half of India's production comes from the state of Karnataka, and the remaining states, Kerala and Tamil Nadu, also cultivate Indian coffee. So these are the traditional cultivating states. Then we have the non-traditional areas like the states of Andhra Pradesh and Odisha, which cultivates around 17% of Indian coffee, and even some of the northeastern states produce coffee. See, the commercial plantations of coffee were started by the British entrepreneurs during the 18th century. For better management of the coffee sector, in 1942, Coffee Board was established. It was established under the Coffee Act 7 of 1942. Now, this coffee board functions under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. And the headquarters of this coffee board is at Bengaluru in the state of Karnataka. So the core activities of this coffee board is to enhance the production, productivity and quality of coffee, and even supporting the development of domestic market and then export promotion of coffee in order to get higher value returns for Indian coffee. In this context, you need to know about the growing conditions for Indian coffee and some of the varieties. Coming to the growing conditions, it is essential to provide proper shade or cover to coffee plants in order to protect them from high radiation levels and rising temperatures. In India, if you see, there are some coffee growing regions with high elevations, which are best suited for growing Arabica type of coffee, which is of mild quality, and some other coffee growing regions have warm humid conditions which are best suited for Robusta type of coffee. So the two major types are Arabica and Robusta. Now let us see some of the important varieties of Indian coffee. One is the Ken's Arabica and second is the Robusta coffee. Apart from that, we also have Selection 795, then Kaveri coffee and even Selection 9. See, all these varieties differ in their flavor, quality and tolerance to leaf rust. In this context, also know in brief about the International Coffee Organization. See, it was set up in London in the year 1963 under the auspices of United Nations. It is basically an intergovernmental organization for coffee. It brings together the exporting governments as well as the importing governments in order to tackle the challenges that the world coffee sector faces through international cooperation. And this International Coffee Organization administers this International Coffee Agreement is an important instrument for development of cooperation between the coffee producing countries and the coffee consuming countries. And India is one of the major coffee producing countries as well as one of the major coffee consuming countries. It is a member of this International Coffee Organization. So remember this fact, and this is in brief about coffee that you need to know from prelims perspective. With this information, let us look at this question. It is a three statement question and you need to choose those statement or statements that are correct. Look at the first statement. It tells that in India, more than 80% of coffee is cultivated by the southern states of Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. See, Karnataka cultivates around 54% of India's coffee and Kerala 19% and Tamil Nadu about 8%. So 54 plus 19 plus 8 is more than 80%. So these are the major states where the coffee is grown. So the first statement is correct here. Sometimes you do get statements with factual numbers like this statement. Now look at the second statement. It tells that the coffee board, which supports the development of domestic market and export promotion of Indian coffee, functions under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. If you remember, we saw that the coffee board functions under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So you can tell that the second statement is incorrect. Now look at the third statement. It tells that India is a member of the International Coffee Organization. This is a correct statement. So here the correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now let us move on to the next news article. Now let us look at this question, which has been framed based on this news article, which mentions that the ruling party in the state of Tamil Nadu has moved the Supreme Court for the implementation of 50% OBC reservation for those state surrendered seats in the All India quota. And this is for the all undergraduate and postgraduate medical courses for the year 2020-2021. So based on this, what we have done is we have framed a question on the constitutional provisions relating to reservation in educational institutions. And this question is about Article 15. If you look at this Article 15, it provides for the prohibition of discrimination on grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. Now, don't get confused. It is because there are certain exceptions to this general rule of non-discrimination under Article 15. The exceptions empower the state to make special provisions for admission to educational institutions and also in matters of employment. Now, let us focus on the educational institutions. One exception is that the state is empowered to make any special provision for the advancement of any socially and educationally backward classes of citizens or for the members of scheduled castes or scheduled tribes regarding their admission to educational institutions. This includes admissions to private educational institutions as well, whether aided or unaided by the state. One more thing which you need to know is that it is not applicable to the minority educational institutions. And this is as per Article 15, Clause 5. Now, if you remember, the same kind of exception was provided to the economically weaker sections in the year 2019 through the 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act. This amendment inserted a new clause, number 6, to Article 15. And under subclause B of this new clause, the state is empowered to make any special provision for the advancement of economically weaker sections. It includes special provisions relating to their admission to educational institutions, including private educational institutions other than the minority educational institutions. So these are some of the provisions that pave way for the government to make provisions for reservation of seats in educational institutions. So try to know the constitutional provisions related to reservation in educational institutions. Now look at this question. It is a two-statement question and you need to choose those statement or statements which are correct. Look at the first statement. It tells that Article 15 empowers the state to make special provisions for the advancement of socially and educationally backward classes of citizens for admission to private and minority educational institutions. This statement is not correct because we saw that the special provisions are not for the minority educational institutions. Now, look at the second statement. It tells that it empowers the state to make special provisions for the advancement of economically weaker sections of citizens for admission to private educational institutions other than minority educational institutions. Yes, this statement is correct. So here the correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now, if you look at this news article, what the ruling party in Tamil Nadu has done is that it has petitioned the Supreme Court that the central government has failed to ensure that reservation happened for OBCs under All India Quota category. And this petition has been filed under Article 32 of Indian Constitution. This Article 32 speaks about the remedies for enforcement of fundamental rights, that is the right to constitutional remedies. So anyone can move the Supreme Court for enforcing the fundamental rights. Also, the Supreme Court has the power to issue directions or orders or writs, including habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, quo warranto, and certiorari, which we discussed in detail yesterday. So from this news article discussion, we have seen about Article 21 and Article 32. Now let us move on to the next news article. Now let us look at this question which has been framed based on this news article. See, recently we know that the central government under Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana offered to pay both employee and employer share into their EPF accounts for the months of March, April and May. And then under Pradhan Mantri Atmanirbhar Yojana, this was extended for 3 more months to the months of June, July and August. Now, if you look at this news article, it gives some statistics on how far this has been implemented. The Employees Provident Fund Organization, in short EPFO, has settled withdrawal claims worth around 11,500 crores during the last 2 months of April and May. See, an analysis was done on slab-wise wage data and it was found that more than 74% of the total PF claimants during the lockdown period belong to the slab of less than 15,000 rupees wage. And this news article mentions them as low wage earners. If you look at the high income category, whose wages are more than 50,000 rupees, accounted for only 2% of the total claimants. And the remaining 24% of claims were made by the members with wages falling between 15,000 and 50,000 rupees category. Now, in this context, you need to know the concept of provident fund. See, the word provident means planning carefully for the future. Know that provident fund is a fund in which deposits of any classes of employees are received and held on their individual accounts. So, employees give a portion of their salaries to the provident fund. And the employers must also contribute on behalf of their employees. And this money is then controlled by the government. So, for this, we have the Employee Provident Fund scheme. It is a retirement savings scheme which the government of India has mandated for all salaried employees in India. In simple words, it is a platform that allows salaried employees to save a certain part of their monthly income in order to build a corpus for their post-retirement life. So know that this scheme comes under the Employees Provident Funds and Miscellaneous Provisions Act of 1952. And under this scheme, all organizations in India that have more than 20 employees, as per this 1952 Act, is mandated to register with Employees Provident Fund Organization. Additionally, know that there are certain exceptions to this rule. Now, coming to this 1952 Act, this Act and all those schemes coming under this Act are managed by the Central Board of Trustees. And it is assisted by the Employees Provident Fund Organization. One scheme which we are seeing now is the Contributory Provident Fund. Apart from this, the Central Board of Trustees also manage the pension scheme and the insurance scheme for the workforce who are engaged in the organized sector in India. And as we saw, it is assisted by the Employees Provident Fund Organization. This organization is under the administrative control of Ministry of Labour and Employment. Now, we need to know one important section under this 1952 Act. As per Section 12 of this Act, the employer cannot deduct employer share of provident fund from the wages of employees. That is, they cannot reduce the wages of the employees. Any such deduction is a criminal offense. So, on a monthly basis, the employees will be contributing to this fund. And on retirement, the employees will get a lump sum amount, including the self-contribution as well as the employer's contribution, along with the interest on both the contribution. So, you can see that schemes like this Employees Provident Fund scheme aims to ensure old age protection for the organized workers. But if you see, there are no such mandatory schemes for those laborers who are working in the unorganized sectors, like street vendors, midday meal workers, head loaders, etc. So this is in brief about this Employees Provident Fund and about the Employees Provident Fund Organization that you need to know from exam point of view. Now look at this question. Consider the following statements. Two statements are given and you need to choose those statement or statements that are incorrect. Look at the first statement. It tells that Employees Provident Fund is a retirement savings scheme applicable to salaried employees working only in organized sectors. Yes, this statement is correct. Don't get carried away by the word only. This scheme is applicable only to organized sector workers. Now look at the second statement. It tells that the Employees Provident Fund Organization comes under the administrative control of Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. This statement is an incorrect statement. It comes under the administrative control of Ministry of Labour and Employment. Now you need to choose those statement or statements that are incorrect. Here the correct answer is option B, 2 only, since the second statement is only incorrect. Now let us move on to the next news article. Let us look at this question which has been framed based on these four news articles. See, all these four news articles mention one protected area each. And whatever news that is present in these news articles is trivial from exam point of view. But try to know the protected areas that are mentioned in all these news articles. Now, if you look at this news article, it mentions about a fire in one of the oil wells in the state of Assam. And it mentions a protected area, Dibru-Saikova National Park. So know that Dibru-Saikova National Park is located in the state of Assam. Now look at this news article which has appeared in the Delhi edition, which speaks about the order that is to be issued by the forest officials to tranquilize a tiger that has killed 5 people. And it mentions about the protected area, Tadoba Andheri Tiger Reserve. Know that it is located in the state of Maharashtra. Next, look at this news article which has appeared in Trivandrum edition, which mentions the protected area, Silent Valley National Park. Know that it is located in the state of Kerala. And finally, look at this news article which speaks about Vedanthangal Bird Sanctuary. Know that it is located in the state of Tamil Nadu. The news is that the State Board for Wildlife has forwarded a proposal to National Board for Wildlife to reduce the buffer area of Vedanthangal Bird Sanctuary for expansion of a pharmaceutical company that is located near the bird sanctuary. So these are the four protected areas that you can know from exam perspective from these four news articles. So many times you do get such news articles. If you come across any protected area like a wildlife sanctuary or a national park or a bird sanctuary or a tiger reserve, just try to know in which state it is located. With this information, now let us look at this question. Consider the following pairs. Three pairs are given: Vedanthangal Bird Sanctuary, Tadoba Andhari Tiger Reserve and Silent Valley National Park, and the states have been given here. You need to find the correctly matched pairs. Here all the three pairs are correctly matched. So the correct answer here is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Now let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. Today we have two mains questions. Now look at this first mains question. Climate experts project that the global heat up by 4 degrees Celsius by the end of this century as per the current trends of emissions of carbon dioxide. In the light of the above statement, discuss various measures taken to mitigate climate change and global warming. See, this is a very generalized question. All you need to write is about various measures taken at the international level to mitigate climate change and global warming. Now look at this question. In recent days, China and Pakistan have joined their hands in challenging India's presence in the Kashmir-Ladakh region. But India cannot conflate the disputes with China and Pakistan as they require different strategies. Discuss. Both these questions are 15 marks question. Answer them in 250 words. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, press the like button, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.